contractor for the University of Alaska Southeast as a contractor. I work for a university in Canada as a contractor, so I'm kind of like just, you know, making my life without having organizations direct the work that I need to do. So what I've been doing really is working through this notion of healing through our own culture and our language, and focusing on what it means to decolonize our methodologies. So it really is to look to our elders and to try to revitalize the Tlingit way of doing things. And so, and then looking too to ownership of materials, intellectual property, and all of these things. And so those have been very, very important constructs for Indigenous peoples. And so it is that we have elders who sit like this in my circles. We have dialogue and discussion, and we talk about things that matter to us. And one of the things that really matters, one of our most treasured objects in the Tlingit system, is our children. And so we set up our knowledge and our ways of being, and we connect them for our children so that our culture and language would perpetuate and live on into the future. And so that's kind of the work that I've been doing. And I did a boarding school curriculum with 30 of our elders last year, and or 2 years ago, and you saw at the last clan conference the elders and their testimonies and what they endured and what they were moving towards. And from that, we developed a curriculum for kindergarten to grade 12. And the other thing that we did with that is that we influenced the Juneau School District. And so that we could start to begin telling our stories of migration. We could make connections to our oratory. And we could make connections to place-based education. And so it is through this notion of decolonization. How do we bring back what is ours, what is Tlingit? And so one of the things that the elders really were stressing moving forward is they wanted Tlingit people to teach Tlingit constructs. And the reason they wanted that is because they wanted to perpetuate Tlingit culture and language. So it was for that reason only, and not because of any other reason. And so that's kind of what we've been doing, is attempting to bring Tlingit culture back to ourselves and discussing it amongst ourselves so that we can influence research in other levels. I work, and some of my work I'm doing right now is with Arctic Council, so I sit there on the Sustainable Development Working Group from an Arctic region. We are focusing on environment and education and culture and language and this perpetuation of what it means to have Indigenous knowledge. And so we're really focusing in on that from an Arctic region, from a very sort of homegrown kind of way. So we have Indigenous peoples who come from Alaska and Siberia, inland, and Sweden, and all of those places, and come in and talk about what it is, what Indigenous knowledge is. And we always come back to this notion of healing, that our culture and our language are healing to us as Indigenous peoples. And many of you know what occurred or what happened to Indigenous peoples through boarding school, but it that wasn't the beginning. Since the time of contact, that Indigenous peoples have been sort of placed outside of the decision-making realm. They haven't been able to feel any connection, or they had a connection to the land, but that connection was policied out. And that story was true not only for here, but for Canada as well. I'm Canadian, I'm an inland Tlingit Teslin. So these are some of the things that I came to realize working in Alaska and having grown up under the banner of self-determination, knowing what it means to be self-governing, and then coming here and seeing, you know, a little piece of ground in Klapawan, or which is about this size, right here, and a flag in the middle of it, and that's their native land. And it's fenced off. So you can see what we wound up with here on this side of the border. And so it is that we teach our children about self-determination and the land base that they had, and they still have. We never gave it up. Even though the ownership is held by someone else, we have traditional territories, and that's what we're coming to understand. So this notion of healing has also enabled someone like myself, a Canadian Tlingit, to come to the U.S. side and be Tlingit, be counted as Tlingit. And so that is really, I think that has been immensely healing as well. So thinking, you know, about my talk today, I prepared the script, and I don't really have the PowerPoint set up. You know, and this is it is about holding on to our Tlingit culture through research and education, and a paper that I wrote and is published out of Germany. So, and this is kind of it. So it really does, you know, talk about how we acknowledge in the beginning of our talk the people, our ancestors that stood behind us. So you'll hear in Kuif when people stand up and say it's not me that is you know, accepting this, it's because of this notion of ancestry and this notion of being who we are. It's not me who's telling you this. This is all of the people that I've been working with in my circles, all of the elders who have informed me, who have been so generous with their knowledge and with their teachings to aid me. When I started my education, of course, you know, I was a young person like everybody else. Public school told me that my stories were a lie. Public school told me that, you know, Indians were drugs. Public school said that because I was Indian, I wouldn't make it. You know, so all of these things. And my mother shared with me that when I was 5 years old, I was jumping up and down on the bed saying, I'm going to be a doctor, I'm going to be a doctor. And so it is to realize that children know what they want when they are very young. And as educators, it's our obligation to assist them and aid them to get where it is that they want. So what I'm kind of leading up to, I hope, is I'm now developing a research grant through the National Science Foundation to work with 30 Tlingit elders to revitalize the Tlingit way of knowing, to revitalize the Tlingit learning framework and the science framework. That is going to inform ourselves for when we have our own events and our own cultural events and our own education and teaching events, that we're going to have a framework that we can actually use that has been agreed upon by a body of people, and not just anybody, but it's balanced, where you have the Raven people, the Raven elders, and you have the Eagle elders. And starting to take away this notion of one person being praised, coming back to the collective. So these are all sort of our methods that we need to revitalize, because that's healing to us. That's healing to us as individuals. I didn't realize what how extraordinary my journey has been. Being Indigenous and having having my mother go to boarding school and having someone like my father, who was such a proud man, being basically told that you can't go here because of the color of your skin, that you can't have that job because of the color of your skin. And so being oppressed as Indigenous peoples. And so it was to kind of pull on that, I think, and move forward in a very healing way to understand why are we doing the work we're doing currently. It is to embrace our Cleagut culture and to embrace our elders in such a way that we can sort of unpack a modern way of thinking about how to teach Cleagut. So we call that decolonizing all our methodologies as well. So we are working frantically on that as well. And it comes down to having hard conversations and taking a hard stand on some things. So that's kind of where I've been, what I thought my presentation would be. It's not really, I had a PowerPoint, of course, and I'm not able to upload it, so.
Do you?
I don't like PowerPoint.
Oh, I broke it.
Yeah.
So this is good.
Okay, good. Because, so I had hoped that in other sessions that I do, I like to hear the voices of people too, to hear your experiences working with culture, working with healing. And what does that mean for you and your work? Because in our Indigenous way, all of us have knowledge. We've all come here with our own experiences and the work we do. So they asked us to not necessarily be speakers, but facilitators. So, and this is a new thing too, coming up in Arctic Council, that researchers we're wanting them to become facilitators of knowledge as well as gatherers of knowledge. So it's not just that you go and mine Indigenous communities for knowledge, but that you're able to share knowledge back out. So I'm hoping that we can all share our stories as well.
Are you from Teslin or from another community?
I'm from Teslin originally. My country is in Canada. And we migrated up the Taku. That's how we occupied.
Mm-hmm.
That's how we are a part of the Alaskan region. Mm-hmm. And I guess an example of healing is we erected some totem poles in the Juneau at the Juneau School District. So at the Douglas School, there was a road built over graves in 1956, and so those graves were the graves of Taku people. And my mother talked about her ancestors being buried somewhere in Douglas Island. So now that totem pole actually does have the ravens on top, the three ravens. Those ravens are facing the inland. So it's our stories are beginning to connect us again as Cleagut people. And it's we're building new artifacts and ways of recording our history so that history's not forgotten. So this is the trail we're leading for our children. You know, I was just in a language session where we heard a plea from an elder that, you know, we needed to really come back to our language, because in our languages there's a certain worldview that cannot be expressed in English. And I think that's part of the journey of me is working with elders. They often speak in their languages, and I'm beginning to understand, which I'm thrilled when I hear something and I can actually make it out. It's really an incredible journey. attorney to be a Clinkit person today, and considering all of the things that we've gone through. That's so then a long way. That's where I'm from.
How is it that your article was published in Germany? Was it not published in a Canadian or American journal?
Because I just, they asked for writers, and I decided that that was where I was going to write. And so my article was about learning how to be Clinkit through research and education. Because it's not kind of the place that you would think that you would learn how to be Clinkit is through education and through research. But it was part of my journey. And so where the story got straightened out actually was through through this notion of Clinkit literacy, which is on our petroglyphs and on our totem poles and on our face paints.
And blankets.
And our blankets, yes. So these are all the places that Clinkit have found ways to express their stories. And these are the testimonies that Clinkit have left behind. And sometimes it is that the researchers came in and perhaps their ears didn't understand the Clinkit language, or that they could misunderstand something and they got the story mixed up. So how my research actually looked at it was to compare the literature to the Clinkit way of understanding things. So through oratory, through the face paints, through the petroglyphs, through my clan blanket, and through drawings, the story got put in its right place, which was immensely healing to me as a person, an Indigenous person, to realize, oh my gosh, that we actually do have a writing system, that we're not illiterate people, that we are literate people. So it was to start to unpack all of those negative messaging that I had heard from a very young age about Indigenous peoples. So it's not that long ago that that we're coming out of this. And so we are working, I think, very, very strongly together to ensure that we bring our culture and language back. Not only for ourselves through our academies, but through our schools, through influencing curriculum. So these are some of the things that we do. And we find that to be, why do we do it? It's so that our children will never forget who they are, so that there's a sense of identity, so that we can reduce the suicide rates, or so that we can move forward. And these are sort of global endeavors of all Indigenous peoples in the Arctic. And that's what we're moving towards. And it's the perpetuation and the decolonization of our way of thinking, our methods. And so, you know, I do it through groups of elders like this. I spend very little time talking. Usually, I listen. I take notes, I reconstruct it, I bring it back to them. I say, is this the way I heard you say it? They say click, and they tell me again. Yes. Then I will rewrite it and ask them again until we get it right. So that is incredible. To work with elders is an incredible, incredible gift. I don't know how I lucked out, but it's really amazing to be a part of their group and to facilitate their knowledge as well as be a researcher. Their knowledge. Yeah.
Some more history from Douglas Island. Maybe more from my perspective. I trained as a historian. I have a friend who grew up in June, a white lady, and she was 14 when the Indian village was burned. People were out fishing, and there are documents about how it happened, but the village was burned and the land was cleared to be used as
and then looking at front page headlines of the Juno paper. I think there was a Douglas paper too. I saw no mention of it contemporaneously. And I think, well, yeah, because there was a newspaper editor who was telling a story, deciding, as your people do, decide what goes in the row or what gets carved in the rock. He decided what would be on that piece of paper. And it brought home to me that even English language newspapers are not everything. They had a specific perspective and they only put in what they were going to put in. And part of what's gone wrong in teaching history is giving too much weight to what was the accepted conventional story. And I appreciate the chance to hear other people's stories, partly because it gives me a critical eye towards what I read in the conventional, you know, the newspaper, the matter of record, we say. It really isn't. But it takes hard work, and it takes reading other people's, reading the letters and asking the people who were around and being willing to hear the hard stories. And there's a time when you don't do that because it's too contemporary. But maybe there comes a time when you do want to call out names and say, there was someone who made money off that deal. There was someone, no matter who his father was, who went along with that when we know now he shouldn't
have. And we have come to that place.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Clink people have such big hearts. And they never want to hurt people. They never want people to go around and feel guilty. And so they don't call out names. They don't point fingers. But we say today it's a matter of accepting and moving on because we persevered as we always have. So that was what really changed me in working with the boarding school table, was that I learned I wasn't a victim anymore. I'm not a victim of what happened. We persevered. We are that strong. We have little elements of our history in each of us. And that's why we needed to be collective. That's why we need to sit together and talk about it. Because that methodology is actually very healing, because they start to speak their languages. They eat the foods from the land. They're happy to be together. They're elders who are talking and conversing. And me, as their facilitator, I get, I'm gifted to hear that. And I can start, in some way, it's starting to penetrate my English ears. The sounds, the Tlingit sounds, when people are talking now, you see me nod a little bit. And I'm like, wow, I'm nodding, because I understand. Because when I came here 3 years ago, I probably had about 30 Tlingit words in my vocabulary, and I've got probably now over 100 words that I know. And so when I'm able to put phrases together, and that's very healing, because we need to bring our language forward again, and I'm not sure how we're going to do that. And we're starting. Some of our elders say it's a university kind of language because it's very general. It's not specific to our communities and dialects, so we're re-examining how we're teaching Tlingit. We are celebrating the dialects and the nations you come from. We're starting to take away this notion of everything being very general and one, but coming back to being a community. So these are just some of the things that we're doing. So I don't know if anyone has anything else to say, but
do you work in collaboration with other
No, this is with Gold Belt Heritage Foundation, and so Gold Belt Heritage has a film, we film all gatherings. Yeah, and usually I'll have a minute taker, someone to take minutes, because that helps me then when I'm reconstructing the curriculum to work and the teaching points that we need to do for schools. Because it's very based on what the elders are saying. We're not looking to books and literature to put our work together. We are getting it from the source. So it's very Clinkett based.
Are there contacts with, or do you have contacts with other Indigenous peoples? Like I think you mentioned the Sami, the Maori are possibly the politically strongest and best organized Indigenous group and with the strongest voice.
We disagree. No, the Maori do have moved forward with this whole notion of education and decolonization.
I'm sorry, the notion of comparison is not appropriate here.
Yeah.
But they have a very strong voice.
They have a very strong voice as well, yes. And I think, you know, that's one of the things through my program at UAF, we did have Maori voices in our circles. We had voices from the Pacific. We also had voices from the Arctic. So it was all of us coming together and talking about what we needed to talk about, which was, you know, the revitalization of our culture and our language, and this, again, this notion of decolonization. And so what does that mean to us and moving forward with that?
Could I ask another question, which is about what the word Indigenous actually means?
Well, that's what the Clinkett people, the elders have in Juneau, have said, do not use the word Indigenous with us. It's Clinkett. We are Clinkett. So, but when we are researching, we need to use that word. And when we're in the Arctic region, we use the word Indigenous to separate out the ones who came in to visit and those people who are from the land.
So my specific question is, Indigenous can only be there cannot be an Indigenous people without a colonizer, is that correct?
I don't know if that's right. I mean, the Clinkett have always been here, colonized or not.
Right. I get puzzled by the term because
it's a convention.
Let's say people who live in England are not called Indigenous.
But England has had waves of conquest. So I think that there may be pockets of people in England who are still Picts, but the waves of Vikings and Normans, I would have said that the English are not Indigenous.
And the way we look at it in our circles is that everybody is Indigenous to this earth. Everyone has a land that their ancestors have come from. And that's the way we look at Indigenous, and that's how we've come to define it. So the Indigenous peoples of this region are the Clinkett.
So, well, and the difference between a homeland or your life world, your homeland, as opposed to land that is exploitable or used for exploitation are two sort of very different kinds of things. And I think this came out very much in the studies when they were building the pipeline and when Justice Berger was writing the Canadian judge.
Tom Bridget, he
wrote about this quite a bit in terms of the Mackenzie River people and the Mackenzie River Valley, because that is how they won their battle, was they were very good at being able to declare, define, and explain the difference between their homeland and what this meant to them, as opposed to just land that exploitable was going to be, there's a word for this, there's a term for this kind of way of looking for.
term indigenous actually is part of the United Nations conventions, and there's rights that are afforded to indigenous peoples.
Yes.
And so under those conventions, we use those words to empower us in the international setting or whatever setting. We bring those conventions out when we need them as tools.
But in relation to that, if the indigenous people were still the owners of their land, they would not need these rights. They only need these rights because of the oppressors, the colonizers.
Well, and
the indigenous people colonized other indigenous people.
Absolutely.
That's that tradition.
Yeah.
Colonized the EX, you know.
And the Athabascans.
Yes. So it's
okay. Well, and that's the thing. I mean, we come to the Yukon, you will not see a good representation of Northern Shoshone or Southern Shoshone art pieces.
Yeah.
It's all Tlingitized. Why? Because we colonized the Yukon. The Tlingit did. And, you know, was it us that did that, or was it the outsiders who came in and saw our beautiful work and said, that's what we're going to celebrate. That's the work of the Yukon.
So we must make it like that.
And we have to have it like that, so when you're, and that's right. So it comes down again to viewpoints and trying to tease away and decolonize those viewpoints. So it's really, it's work that you really have to dig down deep into sometimes.
Yes.
And there's lots of discomfort sometimes because you can't resolve things.
And it's very complicated.
Yes.
Because of these, because of history in our life.
Yes.
And the, I agree totally. You really have to dig in there, and you have to do a lot of self, I think, reflecting and thinking about, well, you know, what about me? What am I doing with my work, or what am I doing with my work? I mean, you know, am I continuing in some way to continue to be a person who is planting the seeds of oppression or colonizing others? You know.
Well, and I think for me, the reflection comes down to how do I bring back what is truly Tlingit? So that's how I examine or move forward with my work. It's a different way of setting the question. So it is to how do I make sure that my work is Tlingit? That's kind of where I'm coming from, and that has really taken, I think, a lot of courage in some ways. To try new things or to say things that are not popular.
Yeah.
You